Welcome back to the It's Just Boar podcast paper review. I'm Joanna Reardon.
I'm Niamh Tallon. Today we are bringing you the latest in sport. We are going to kick off with golf. HerSport's Olivia Mehaffey finished third place at the Oscar Williams Classic. Having just recently turned professional, Mehaffey will be thrilled with such a result. Leona Maguire is still searching for her first major win after finishing fourth way tie for ninth place in the Medihal, I think that's how you say it, Championships in California over the weekend. This is her third top 10 so far this season after a runner-up place at the Lotto Championship and a sixth place at Drive On. The Cavan native led with a 65 after the opening round but failed to break 70 in her final three rounds. She finished 8 shots off the winner.
In Camogie news, the stage is set for the Camogie National League finals this weekend, as the semi-finals proved to be an incredible weekend and a true demonstration of passion. Sunday's doubleheader in Nolan Park saw Tipperary take on Kilkenny and Cork play Galway. In the first game, Tipperary looked incredibly dangerous and held the ball for most of the game. Their joy was carried well into the second half until the 54th minute, but Kilkenny's Denise Gall fired back with 2 goals in a minute to open the scoreline and see Kilkenny over the line. It looked to be Tipperary's game for the taking, but Kilkenny are the reigning All-Ireland champions for a reason and proved that in the last few minutes with their experience and grit to get it out in the end. The second game between Cork and Galway was a much closer affair and saw the two sides battle it out right until the very end. 2 excellent goals in the first half from Galway's Catherine Finnerty and Cork's Amy O'Connor increased the scoreboard to 1-7 to 1-6 at half-time. The battle continued for the last 30 minutes and even went 20 minutes into extra time, working out in Galway's favour, who eventually got 2 points over the Rebels. Galway will play Kilkenny in the next in the final next weekend. Up to 5,000 fans will be allowed to support them in Croke Park, as it is one of the events being used to test as part of the large crowd system in sports. So all incredibly exciting.
Yeah, no, it's definitely going to shape up to be a great match, and I think people would be delighted to be able to go back into the stadium and, you know, bring some atmosphere and really support the players. In terms of athletics, you know, we've been talking about it lots and lots of times over the past couple of months. Things are really heating up with plenty of action and potential Olympic qualifiers on the horizon. Over in America at the NCAA Championships, Rashida Adelecki ran an incredible 50.96 in the third leg of the 4x400 meter for Texas. It could put her in the mix for a spot on the mixed relay team. Tough competition against Phil Healy and Charlene Maudsley. So it's great to see, you know, such competition and that there's so much pace and depth in the squad. Also at the championships, Eilish Flanagan won the 2,000 metre steeplechase in 6:13.50, a national best and 3 seconds faster than the previous record held by Tokyo-bound Michelle Finn. Limerick duo Sarah Lavin and Kira Neville had a night of conflicting fortunes in Finland as they continued to chase Olympic qualification. Lavin clocked the second fastest time in her career in the 100-metre hurdles at 13.23, while Neville had a below-par run in the 100-metres heat, running 11.86, and then withdrew from the final due to injury. Neville is currently ranked 54th with Olympic places offered to the top 56, while Lavin is 40th in the 100-metre hurdles with 40 places available. Kate O'Connor must wait and see whether she has done enough to secure her ticket to Tokyo. She would have all but guaranteed her place last weekend, but had to pull out of the heptathlon event in Tenerife due to injury. O'Connor is currently ranked 22nd of 24, and if it stays that way, she'll be on that plane. We shared an Instagram and TikTok of Kate O'Connor, and it went absolutely viral. She's certainly an inspiration to a lot of people, and we will be hoping to see her on that Tokyo plane. Sarah Healy is making a real push to secure her place at this year's Olympics. The 20-year-old set a new personal best in the 1500 metres as she took home another win in Sweden. Healy ran 4:07.13, which moves her up to 38th place in the Olympic rankings, the top 45 qualified. So it's looking good for Healy at the moment. It would be an incredible achievement considering her age. She's a double gold medalist from the 2018 European Under 18 Championships, where she set championship records. This week is crucial for all athletes hoping to qualify as the qualification deadline looms at the end of this week. So really looking forward to getting the, you know, the final team in terms of the you know, athletics side of things, because we have a really strong team going, and you know, there's definitely a few more people that are inside those qualification rankings at the moment.
Yeah, it's incredibly exciting, and obviously just wishing everyone all the best and hoping that they make it to Tokyo. Make it on the plane to Tokyo is what I was trying to say. I think we're going to need a bigger plane anyways at this stage. I suppose a group who have already stamped their ticket to get on that plane to Tokyo is the Irish women's hockey team. They ended their European Hockey Championship campaign with a 3-0 win over Italy. It wasn't really the tournament that we as fans would have wanted, but also the team wouldn't have wanted, as they failed to progress from their group and missed out on a World Cup qualification as well. It was a disappointing 1-1 draw against Spain last week. It meant that Ireland missed out on a semi-final place due to goal difference. They saw them obviously progress against England in a must-win game to secure that World Cup qualification. That wasn't to be, however, as England ran out 5-1 winners. Overall, I suppose it was a mixed European Championship with two wins, two losses and a draw. Ireland overall finished in sixth place, but all attention will turn to the big one, which is the Olympic Games in Tokyo, because this is the first time that the Green Army will be there, and we all know the excitement of when they qualified. Jesus, 2 years ago now, I still literally still say, oh, it's just last year, like in my head.
Yeah.
But yeah, there was great excitement in Donnybrook that evening. And yeah, hopefully, you know, with the experience that they've gained from all these tournaments so far, they can make a proper impact in the Olympics. And sure, 'tis anyone's game at this stage.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, you know, when they came up against England, it was always going to be a tough battle. But, you know, they've been playing lots of games in the past couple of weeks as they head towards the Olympics. So, you know, we look forward to seeing what they can do at the Olympic Games in just a couple of weeks, really. In LGFA news, Dublin will face Cork in the 2021 Ladies National Football League final at Croke Park on Saturday, a repeat of last year's All-Ireland final. Dublin secured their place in the final after beating Mayo 4-15 to 10 points. Dublin led by 3-3 to 0-4 at the break, thanks to goals from Niamh Hetherington, Jennifer Dunn and captain Sinead Ahern. Cork, on the other hand, fought hard against a tough Donegal side to win 5-10 to 3-13. It was a goal feast with both teams going tit for tat, but it was the Rebels who experienced shone through. It's an exciting game this weekend. Who are you backing, Joanne?
Oh God, it's so hard to tell, isn't it, from my original bias throughout the last few podcasts. It's hard to tell. I actually did sit down and watch the Cork and Donegal ladies football match on TG Carr. I had a massive situation in our house where my parents had gone to the bog for the day, funnily enough, and I had one TV on in the study, which is our other playroom basically, and that had the Euros, and then the TV, which is the bigger TV in the sitting room, had the ladies football on. So I was dashing back and forth. I was like convinced, I was like, have I messed up the channels? Like, is this the Euro that I'm watching with all these goals like coming through? Like, what's going on? No, look, it was obviously great. I think Cork had the experience to grind out Donegal in the end, and I think it was good to see that they had that momentum, I suppose, swing with them. Just some incredible goals. Obviously they'll have to tighten up obviously in defense from a Cork perspective, and I think Efi knows this anyway, so he's no joke. But I think it will be an incredible game, and I think it will be incredibly tense, and I think we should hopefully see some fireworks, because mm-hmm. there's usually fireworks between Cork and Dublin. So yeah, I know, looking forward to it. I'm actually buzzed to get my second vaccine, because then I can actually start going to games. I've like said to myself, once I get fully vaccinated, like, there's no stopping me. And like, my poor dad, like, he's the same, but like, he's on a 12-week delay with his, so I'm like, bye dad, like, I'm gone.
Yeah, no, it's going to be great to have people back in stadiums, and it's going to shape up to be an exciting weekend of sport.
Yeah, it should be really good. Over in soccer news, there was a break in the Women's National League this week as the Irish national team prepared for their friendly games. The action got underway on Friday night after the team came back from losing 3-0 at halftime to finish 3-2 against Iceland. It was a poor first half performance, I think everyone admits that, but goals from Heather Payne and Amber Barrett in the second half saw some positives in the game. The girls follow on with a second game against Iceland on Tuesday night. I think we all know that conceding sloppy goals from an Irish perspective is kind of the downfall to this whole team, and I think it is something that they do need to tighten up on in terms of defence. I think obviously Grace Maloney is the starting goalkeeper. I know there was a bit of mix-up between, or not a mix-up, but there was like some swapping and chopping and changing mm-hmm. with it. I think obviously having Louise Quinn in the back line, you know, I think she marshals it very well. Obviously Katie McCabe goes forward. I think just the problem is that they've no one to cover back when Katie McCabe goes forward. I think it leaves the two girls incredibly exposed in the middle. That would just be my perspective, but I think that's the way football is in general. But no, look, I think overall it was good. I think it's good to see Amber Barrett back. She is a proven goal scorer, especially over in Germany. I know she's been going very well. And I don't know if you saw that the FAI had posted today a really cool interview with Heather Payne going through college and camp life. And she was basically just like, yeah, it's totally fine. I was like, that's the look of someone who's obviously just playing football and putting the laptop to one side. But no, look, obviously it's incredible to see. And it's incredible to see the young girls as well coming through. I think it was disappointing. I think a lot of Cork people expected Saoirse Noonan to be on. So fingers, I don't know what the story is there, but maybe we'll see. But yeah, look, some women's National League representatives as well, I have to say.
Yeah, no, it's brilliant. And look, you know, obviously there's another game as well. We do actually have some news that we haven't shared with the audience yet. So whoever listens to the podcast is getting some inside goss. Louise Quinn is a HerSport ambassador. So that is the latest HerSport ambassador to add to the team. We finalized everything last week, but we didn't make the announcement just yet. So anybody that listens gets the inside scoop on that. There is actually some more news. Just in terms of badminton. So there was silver for Rachel Darragh at the Lithuanian International. She lost out in the final to Malvika Bansod, I'm going to say. But yeah, no, it's great to have, obviously, her getting the opportunity to compete and getting a result over there as well. So congratulations to Rachel. I guess the other news that we wanted to have a quick discussion was, a bit of what's going on internationally. So, we've seen on social media this week about the Australian swimmer, Madeline Groves, who has withdrawn from the Olympic trials next week. She is citing misogynistic perverts in the sport and has said that she, won't compete. But there's been a lot of different things kind of going around, and it's hard to know really what the story is with it. I'll give you a bit of an overview of what I've seen, and then you let me know kind of what you've seen as well. She is a 26-year-old swimmer for Australia who has won silver medals in the 200-meter butterfly and 4x100-meter medley at the 2016 Rio Games. She had previously raised concerns on social media about a man who stared at her in her swimsuit and made her feel uncomfortable. Then she said, "Whoa, guys, this may have worked." She said the next day, "Next time you have a weirdo stare at your tits and your complaints fall on deaf ears, try tweeting about it." In an Instagram post on Friday, she expressed additional concerns about body shaming. "My decision to withdraw is partly because there's a pandemic on, but mostly it's the culmination of years of witnessing and benefiting from a culture that relies on people ignoring bad behaviour to thrive. I need a break." Bowman said that Swimming Australia has reached out to Groves this week, but that she has not responded. In an additional social media post on Wednesday, she explained her decision to withdraw and said, "Let this be a lesson to all misogynistic perverts and their bootlickers. You can no longer exploit young girls and women, body shame or medically gaslight them, and then expect them to represent you so you can earn your annual bonus." I did watch an interview just there with Kieran Perkins. He is the president of Swim Australia. To be honest, I thought he seemed to deflect it a little bit. He talked about kind of her health and maybe inferred she wasn't in shape to qualify. I'm not sure. And that's kind of the tone that I was getting from him, and was kind of saying like, oh, she's not in shape, so she's kind of saying this and maybe to pull out and not have to race and then not get selected. I'm not sure, but that seemed to be a little bit of the angle he was going. He was definitely talking about her health a bit. And then he was told by the people that were interviewing him that she had apparently reported an incident in November of last year. And as the president of the organization of something that is going on and is being followed worldwide, he said he didn't know anything about it. So I'm not sure how news reporters could get that story, and the president of the organization, who is surely being interviewed by lots and lots of people, didn't know about an incident that she had reported. Surely at this stage he'd have found out the details. But yeah, I don't know. What have you seen? It all seems a bit strange. It's kind of, her tweets are a little bit cryptic on that. There's not a whole lot of detail in it really, which, I mean, obviously that's really up to her, but it's kind of hard to know what's going on.
That's what I was kind of going to say. She's been very, well, bar the, let this be a lesson to all misogynistic perverts and their bootlickers and a man staring at your tits. I mean, she very much is describing what is going on in Swim Australia, but she has yet to like, I'm not saying like we need a name or like anything like that, but you know, it's yet to be like, was it a fan in the stand? Was it like a coach? You know, like, was an administrator? You know, like all this kind of stuff. And I was like reading how Alex Bowman, their new chief executive, how he, it was obviously such a serious accusation that he called an impromptu press conference at the trials, and he basically said they haven't got an official complaint from her, they reached out to her and that she didn't get back to them, and that they also will set up an independent panel which will just have women on it so they can talk about female issues and guide Swimming Australia that way. I was also reading how this isn't the first time in Australia this is happening, how... In gymnastics in Australia, they're currently going through a bit of a rough patch, you know, with claims of abuse, claims of bullying, all the stuff, I suppose, that we've heard in different
from
sports, I suppose, throughout the world. And from gymnastics as well, I think an independent review there basically said that sometimes the culture in these organizations is so bound that no matter what an independent panel will say, that it's actually going to take a long time for this to actually change. And I think we do know that ourselves with culture kind of in general, like, it does take a long time for that to happen. I think going back to the Maddie Groves problem, obviously, look, I mean, I think if a situation obviously has arisen, which she's very adamant that it has, it is something very serious and obviously needs to be investigated. You know, because I know that's something me and you used to joke about as well. And I know we had Beth Carson on and I'd always joke like, you know, oh my God, like, it's just so funny being around, like, around swimmers, you know, like, I'm so unfit, or like, blah, blah, blah. And like, obviously these things have an impact on people's health and mental health and objectification and all that kind of stuff. But it is weird, as you said, that Kieran Perkins was told of an allegation that he didn't even know about, and he's president of the organization.
Well, also,
whether that was a way to deflect or avoid, I don't know, a good media tactic. But yeah, it is all a little bit cryptic, and it all is a little bit weird. You know, I was reading an article in The Guardian, and The Guardian basically said, the swimming is in problems, but we actually don't know what the problem is yet. We know it's objectification and stuff, but no one knows what it exactly is.
No, it's hard to know exactly like what she's talking about. And, you know, obviously, like, there's been trouble in swimming before, there's been trouble in gymnastics and that type of thing. You know, gymnastics internationally, there's been issues before. So it's hard to know whether it's kind of as severe as sort of some of the other stories that have come to light previously and the incidents that have occurred. But yeah, in terms of like what she's talking about, like you've said, there hasn't been much kind of clarification on the matter. And Perkins also did mention that they had reached out to her and they haven't heard back from her yet. You know, they also mentioned, you know, that there was a lot of body shaming going on and that some of it was starting like with the kids that were like 11 years old and that type of thing. So I watched another interview with Grant Hackett, where himself and another interviewer discussed some of the difficult culture at present. Hackett talked about the team that he was on in the late 90s and early 2000s and, you know, what things were like back then. And it seems to be quite positive, but they did discuss some other allegations that have been raised recently, which have not been so positive. So, look, I guess we'll keep up to date with what's going on there. You know, again, at the moment, it's very difficult to kind of know what the story is. But I mean, in other swimming news, we will be releasing an article about the infamous Irish Michelle Smith. So if anybody wants to check that out on her sport, definitely do. If you don't know why she's infamous, definitely go over and check it out.
Or watch her like in the years. They do a very good, I'm not joking, they do a very good like analysis of the whole thing. Like, it is neutral.
There's a lot of people not neutral about that, but if you don't know about it, head over
that's why I thought Reading in the Years is one of the better places, because they had no choice or else they'd get sued.
But yeah, look, I think that's all we have for you today. If we missed anything, let us know and we'll be sure to add it in next week. Connect with us on social media at hersport.ie on Instagram and Twitter, and John will let you know her social channels.
At @JoanneOR_OX on Twitter and at @JoanneOR on Instagram. Leave, it's been a pleasure as always.
Absolutely. I hope you got to enjoy some of the sun over the weekend.
I did. It was roasting down in Cork. Yeah. Like, it was a full 26.
It's very humid.
I'm actually like sweating. I'm not turning on the fan because I don't want it echoing in the background. But this is the shiniest podcast we've ever done.
Speak for yourself. All right, I'll let you go and talk to you soon.
Cheerio.
Bye-bye.